open. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, madam. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Good. I'll start again.
Yeah, madam, yeah. Sir.
Yeah. So my patient is a 38-year-old male patient coming from Kochi, a bank employee by profession. He comes with the chief complaints of inability to close both the eyes since 1.5 years, and also complaints of scars over the face and deformities since 1.5 years. He gives history of burns sustained from a stab explosion to his face 2 years ago, for which he was immediately taken to a local hospital, and he gives history of being admitted to the ICU. However, he does not. I do not have information regarding the duration of the stay in the ICU or the ward, and whether he was on ventilatory support. So I would like to ask these things. He gives history of regular dressing and IV medication during the stay. He does not give history of any surgeries done during the stay or after the treatment, after the hospital stay. I would like to ask the patient regarding the duration of the time taken for healing of the wounds and the status at the time of discharge, whether there were any open wounds left for raw areas left for healing by second intention. He gives history of progressive inability to close the eyes and irritation and excessive watering of the eyes. I would like to ask about his present vision, since his eyes have been opened for so long, exposed, and also since he also gives complaints of facial deformities of the eyes and also of the lips. I would like to ask regarding the oral continence. He does not give history of any scar massage or silicone dressing or compression garment used post treatment, hospital treatment. I would like to proceed to the examination, sir. On a general examination, he is vitally stable, conscious, oriented. No phalanges, cyanosis, lymphadenopathy or edema. Local examination, starting from the forehead, it's scarred, shiny with variable pigmentation. There is absence of bilateral eyebrows. The eyes, there's bilateral upper lid ectropion, the partial eversion of the lateral lid margins. There's absence of lashes on the medial aspect of the upper, both the upper eyelids, and on the whole length of the lower eyelids. There is a scar band on the left upper eyelid extending from the lid margin to the lateral part of the left supraorbital ridge. Also, a vertical band from the right upper eyelid to the lateral wall of the nose. He has bilateral lower eyelid ectropion with scleral show, and there is significant pull, there's a downward pull on the left medial canthus. There's bilateral conjunctival dryness and mild corneal opacity is present. Bilateral Bell's phenomena is present. I would also like to examine for the status of the lacrimal punctae and also for his vision. Coming to the nose, is scarred. The dorsum of the nose is scarred with variable pigmentation. There is loss of both bilateral alae. The tip of the nose and columella are scarred, but in normal position. The cheeks are bilaterally scarred with areas of normal skin in the mid cheek region on both sides, just below the lower lid margins. The scars are atrophic medially and supplaterally. There is one large depigmented scar on the left cheek. Bilateral nasolabial folds are obliterated, and there's hyperpigmented contracture bands seen from the lateral walls of the nose to bilateral cheek, covering this, causing the obliteration of the nasolabial folds. The mouth, there is eversion of the lower lip with vermilion show. There's loss of labiomental crease. There is a microstomia with a blunting of the commissures and a band, contracture band on the left commissure. There is absence of lateral half of the left side of the mustache on the upper lip. and there is absent lip seal. I would like to ask regarding, I would like to examine his mouth opening since he has microstomia, and also I would like to assess his speech. In addition, ear in this, I would like to examine the ear in this particular picture that have been given to me. I'm not able to assess the ear, but I would like to assess for the ear. And then coming to the neck, it is scarred, it's thin, supple scar, but no contracture seen in the neck. I have examined the possible donor site, that is bilateral supraclavicular regions are free, and bilateral retroauricular regions I would like to examine for as they are also potential donors for FTSGs. Bilateral thighs are normal. The true defect, I have assessed the true defect with by marking the points of the lid margins from the superior medial lateral orbital margins for the upper eyelid and the superior medial and the lower orbital margin for the lower lid, and I have transposed it on a normal person with eyelids kept in repose and assess the true defect. I would like to give a provisional diagnosis of post-bone contracture deformity of the faces, bilateral upper and lower eyelid, ectropion, lower and lower lip eversion with microstomia. Shall I proceed?
Madam, would you like to ask any questions, sir?
She can go ahead. What is her plan now?
This patient, thank you, sir. This patient has predominantly two set of problems. The most urgent ones are the functional problems, that is bilateral upper and lower ectropion with exposure keratitis and lip eversion and microstomia. He also has aesthetic problems such as nasal deformity, absent eyebrows and loss of the lateral part of the mustache. I would deal with the ectropion first in addition to the lip eversion and the microstomia. So my sequence of management would be to release bilateral upper eyelid ectropion with an cover with an FTSG or a thick skin split thickness graft. And in addition, I would also like to do a release of the lip eversion, lower lip eversion, and commissuroplasty in the same setting. And after a period of 10 days, I would like to go ahead and do the release of bilateral lower lid ectropion and a thick split thickness skin grafting or an FTSG for cover. My but prior to this, I would like to take the routine investigations for anesthesia clearance and do a proper ophthalmic examination to assess the severity of the exposure keratitis and also his status of the vision. Surgery. The bilateral upper head ectropion release, I would like to take the skin crease incisions just proximal to the lid margin on both eyes. I would like to do bilateral ectropion release in this patient in because of the severity of the exposure keratitis, and hence I would like to take some skin crease incisions on either upper eyelid, both upper eyelids, with fish tailing on either end. This incision will progress about 1 centimeter beyond the lateral canthus and onto the nasal lateral wall of the nose. After the incision is being made, I would release the skin till lid has been sufficiently overcorrected, and I would cover it with a full thickness skin graft or a thick split thickness skin graft.
Dr. Angelina, would you like to ask us something?
Yeah, right from the early phase of burn care. Madhavi?
Yes, madam. Yes, madam.
Are you able to hear me? Would you like to know how the fire was put out? Would you like to know about that?
Yes, madam.
Is there an advantage if water was used?
What is the first aid you will give to patient with facial burns, Madhavi? Especially you are dealing with the eye burns, isn't it? Eyelids.
Yes, madam.
If you see the patient in the acute stage, madam wants to know what is the care you will give, first aid to prevent the problem. Yes.
I would like to
want to give some irrigation.
Yes, madam. In the acute stage, I would like to first give a thorough irrigation with 2 to 3 liters of NX and remove any amount of
this
foggy body or and also to
remove what some foreign body or anything is there, you have to release it, remove it. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Go ahead.
Suppose you are using water for putting out fire, no?
Yes, madam.
Reduce the depth of burn.
Madam, I couldn't hear. I couldn't get you, madam.
By doing the irrigation.
You are using water to put out the fire.
Yes, madam.
Does it reduce your depth of burn?
The
when you use water, water cools 23 times faster than any other way of putting out. Okay, so it will reduce the depth of burn. Suppose it is a second degree burn. How do you know that it is a second degree burn?
Second degree burn will have blebs and
Okay. Suppose there is a blister. Will you manage? How will you manage a blister?
A blister, I would not remove the blister, madam, as it would act like a natural cover and allow the re-epithelization from below.
Suppose it is a small blister, less than 1 centimeter. Usually, you do it. What does the blister fluid contain?
If it is a large blister, what will you do?
If it's a large blister, madam asked, what will you do?
Madam, a large blister.
You're supposed to either de-roof it and let out the blister fluid, because blister fluid is supposed to reduce the neutrophil chemotaxis and increases the can act as a medium for bacteria to grow and it can make it deeper. So if it is a large blister, you re-roof it, and if it is a small blister, you leave it. And for the eye, suppose you have a burn over the eye, what is the primary care to give? Immediately, you irrigate with normal saline to let out any carbon or soot particle that is there or any burnt material that is there. Then what will happen? Because in the immediate burn period, what do you observe? In the first 24 hours, you see a burn patient. What do you observe? How the face? What is the appearance of the face?
In the first edema.
Yes, correct.
Edema, there will be a lot of facial edema.
Facial edema. So what is the posing of the patient? You like to maintain if the patient has a daughter facial burn. You try to give a
head elevation. Yes, madam.
About 50 to 45 degrees. Head end needs to be, the head end of the pot needs to be elevated.
Elevated. Yes, okay. Madam. Yes, madam.
The second thing, for the eye, you usually give hourly drops of eye drops. Whatever eye drops usually
lubricant
be with some gentamicin or some eye drops hourly, so that the eye is kept irrigated plus it is free of infection. For the night time, you apply a eye ointment. Suppose there is in the stage 3 or 4, the patient, especially if it is a very deep burn and patient seems to have there is a dryness of the cornea and there is a risk of corneal ulceration. What would you like to do?
I would like to do a temporary tarsorrhaphy, madam. Suture tarsorrhaphy.
Okay. You can do a temporary tarsorrhaphy. And you what are the types of tarsorrhaphy you do?
There is a suture tarsorrhaphy.
Intermarginal tarsorrhaphy can be done, or a lateral
tarsorrhaphy
can be done.
Yes,
okay. And suppose it is only from your thing, you say it is a facial burn and it is deep. As per your history, patient has become stable by 5th day. Would you like to do any early surgery in that patient?
Yes, madam. I can do an early release and skin grafting can be done.
You call it as an early release or something else?
Early.
What do you do in initial phase?
Very deep burn, 3rd degree burn. What do you do?
Tangential excision and graft.
Tangential excision of the burn wound. And what do you do after that?
I would like to put a skin thick skin graft over the
graft over it. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
That will help to avoid the development of sort of deformity. Okay.
Yes,
now the patient, from your history, patient has been managed conservatively and the wound has healed.
Yes, ma'am.
That means the patient should have had a deep dermal burn, but it has been capable of healing within 3 weeks to 1 month. From what you say, there has been no grafting done. No grafting. So now, what is this type of contracture that the patient has developed? Is it an intrinsic contracture or an extrinsic contracture?
It is an intrinsic contracture, madam.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So it is an intrinsic contracture. What do you mean by an intrinsic contracture?
An intrinsic contracture is a contracture occurring over the raw area secondary to the healing process occurring in that area, whereas an extrinsic contracture is a contracture that has developed in an area secondary to a healing process in a nearby area, which causes a pull on this particular.
Okay. Suppose the patient has a post-burn scar over the neck and cheek, which is pulling the eyelid. When there has been no burn on the eyelid, then you call it as a extrinsic contraction. Okay.
Yes, madam.
Now, what are all the stigmata of a facial burn?
Madam, the stigmata of facial burn are ectropion, then shortening of the nose and alar flaring, shortened retruded upper lip with loss of filtral contour, lower lip eversion, inferior displacement of the lower lip, flat facial features, and the loss of jawline definition, madam.
Yes, good. So, now the patient has got all these deformities. Patient invariably have all these deformities. So now you see all that. Now you will need a prioritization of reconstruction. So what is the principle of prioritizing that reconstruction of a facial bone?
The first thing to be dealt with will be the upper eyelids, and then the lower eyelid. Then it is the mouth. Then it is the nose, then the
cosmetic.
The nose reconstruction.
Okay. Suppose the patient has got a very tight microstoma. Patient has developed a very tight microstoma, but his Bell's phenomenon is very good. He has not developed any corneal ulceration. Do you think still the priority will be in your release of eyelid or your microstoma?
In this case, I would like to release the microstoma, madam.
Yeah.
In that case. So, in now case. The principle, when we ask as a principle, you say restoration of function precedes the restoration of anatomical integrity and aesthetic. Okay, pa? So,
yes, ma'am.
The restoration of function. So, in your case, the mouth seems to be adequate enough for having the daily activity of eating. But
yes,
eye seems to suffer more. So, you are prioritized as release of your eyelid. But function, whichever is more demanding, will get your first priority of reconstruction.
Yes,
okay. Now coming to the other small details that you would like to observe in this person, you told about the eyelashes. How about the eyebrows? Are they there?
No, madam. In this patient, he has no eyebrows.
No eyebrows also. What are the function of eyebrow? Do you think it has any function?
Function of the eyebrows. Oh.
Actually, it prevents the dripping of your sweat into the eye. Okay. So,
yes,
that is. So, in this person, when he has no eyebrow, there is a chance of the sweat or anything that comes directly to enter into his eye. Okay.
Yes, madam.
That's this. You said about the corneal opacity. Okay. There was a mild corneal opacity.
Yes,
what are the reasons? Why this person is developing a corneal opacity or corneal tendency for corneal ulceration in eyeball?
There is a limbal ischemia, madam, resulting in corneal ulceration and opacification. And also
the tear formation.
When the tear formation is reduced because of the in response.
But you said he has lacrimation, no? Excessive lacrimation.
There
is there here. But it has some problem. The reason why it is still allowing it to form a dryness of the cornea. Why there is a dryness of the cornea despite the tear being there?
Madam, it is not being retained on the eye.
Yes.
There is eversion of the lower eyelid.
It is not being retained because the movement is going to smear the globe with your tear. What are the glands that are there in your lid?
The molars gland.
Molars muscle.
Meibomian gland, sir. Sorry.
Meibomian gland. These meibomian glands have a secretion. This higher and lipid. When that is added to the tear, the lubrication is maintained for a longer time. Okay.
Okay.
So, because there is no maybe. that being exposed for a longer time results in early evaporation of the tear and dryness. So without corn lubrication, so you'll have to add some artificial tear or some solution to keep the eye irrigated to avoid the ulceration. Okay, so this is the scar. What is the duration of this scar?
The scar, madam. 1.5 years, madam.
1.5 years. So what are the stages of a scar? What are the stages of a scar?
Initially, the scar is immature, where it is hyperemic. There's immature and maturization of scar. In the immature scar, scar is vascular, so it tends to be pink in color. It is can be a little tender, as it matures. Hello, hello.
Okay. Go ahead, go ahead.
As it mature
scar is painless. It has the same, almost the same color as the skin, or probably a little hyperpigmented.
Now the scar, is it mature or immature?
This is a mature scar, madam.
Mature scar. So, what is the time you would like to operate on a patient? When the patient has got this problem, then it is immature or mature?
I would like to wait for maturation for all the scars to mature, madam, before I go ahead with any procedure.
Okay. So another thing that you observed in this patient's left eyelid, lower eyelid, is the punctum. Is how is the punctum?
Punctum cannot be seen, madam. It's obliterated.
Averted because the medial canthus is full, no?
Yes,
as if it is averted. So, what is the likely chance of it getting scarred? So, is there a chance of a nasolacrimal duct damage?
Yes, madam, as it is.
Okay. So, when you are going to do the surgery, release the upper eyelid, as you said, what is the extent from which you would like to release and resurface? That is, what is the limit from which to which you would like to?
The limit, my incision will be placed just proximal to the lid margin, and the release will be from one medial canthus to lateral canthus, but the incision will extend about 1 to 2 centimeters beyond the canthi. So medially onto the it will go onto the nasal wall, and laterally it will extend about 1 centimeter beyond the lateral canthus, and release will be.
Where would you like to make the incision? With respect to your gray line, that upper eyelid has got a gray line, eyelashes, no? And it has got a tarsal plate. Usually, what is the usual margin or limit above the gray line you would like to make a cut? You would like to palpate the tarsal plate and the upper margin, okay? Upper margin of the tarsal plate is the area where you would like to make the incision. Your medial and lateral extensions are right. Okay. Mm-hmm. And would you like to do upper and lower eyelid at the same time or at different time?
No, madam. I would like to do them at different stages because I need to get an over correction of each eyelid in order. In terms of overcorrection, I mean that once it is released, I should be able to overlap the opposite, like the lower lid or the upper lid correspondingly. So if I do both together, I would have to suture the lid margins together, and that would not give me adequate overcorrection.
What is a cross stitch?
Yes, pardon?
What about a cross stitch?
Cross stitch.
No, it's a frost. FROST.
Frost lid.
Frost stitch. Frost stitch. It's called a modified frost stitch.
Madam, I don't know about this.
You would like to keep that is to retract. You make a stitch from the lid margin to keep it down, or to in cases where you want to keep the lid lower lid up, you put it and take it up and keep a tape over it. That's called as a cross stitch.
Okay.
So yes, we'd like to do both the upper eyelids at the same time.
Ideally, it is not recommended because that would make the patient blind, because you need occlusive dressing at least for 5 days. You would make the patient blind for 5 days and dependent on others. But in yes. this patient, since he has both
involved, if it is a pediatric age group, maybe yes, but
maybe
in an adult,
I would like to do one eyelid at a time.
One eyelid at a time. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So after doing correction, how would you like to maintain the graft, or how would you like to maintain that it doesn't go back to contraction?
Madam, I would prescribe the patient massage, where the patient has to massage in a direction opposite to the contracture. That is, in the upper eyelid, it would be from above downwards, and from in the lower eyelid, from below upwards. Then I would also
okay, ma'am, that's right.
Yes.
Suppose for the lower eyelid, what type of a graft would you prefer?
Lower eyelid, I would prefer a full thickness skin graft, madam, because it has the same color match. It has a good color match.
Okay.
Apart from the color match, is there anything else why you want a full thickness graft?
Sir, it has less. It has lesser secondary contracture compared to the split thickness graft. So I would prefer a full thickness graft for the eyelid resurfacing.
Absolutely right, because the lower lid is also pulled down by gravity, so you have to have lesser retraction chances. That's the bigger reason, rather than just the primary reason is functions. In terms of function, the retraction, skin contraction should not happen, so shrinkage happens. So that's why if it's split thickness graft, a full thickness graft is preferred. And of course, secondly, the second reason should be the aesthetics. As Dr. Angelina said, function over form. Go ahead.
Yes, sir.